But just get your Africa tickets ready, baby, because it's coming.
Yo, what up world? It's Eric Mazumpaka with Zion Studios and a very special story today titled Silvan and the Golden Bible. Now, Silvan, blood could have not even made us any closer than we already were. And he was a very, very crucial individual in pivotal moments in my life. You know, the kind of moments that I could go down this road that is dark and not a lot of growth, not a lot of ways out, or B, this beautiful light road and forest, and you know, like the kind of friends that you appreciate, like molded you into the individual that you're meant to be. So for this story, I'm going to need two elements. I'm going to need A, this CD called Spectrum for Africa, presented by Stanford Peace and Student Leadership. And then B, this Golden Bible. Now A, this special, special album, actually I received a few days ago from Sumit and Mr. Markey, the leadership teacher. Mr. Markey and Mr. Gordon were like very close friends that appreciate and love music. The kind of teachers that I was excited to go to school, necessarily go to my classes, kind of a delinquent student. But I'll never forget showing Mr. Gordon this documentary called Invisible Children about displaced child soldiers in Uganda. And the next day he comes to me and he's just so moved by this documentary, and I was moved because I lived there and I could have had a completely different life, you know? It gave me a perspective on life that it was hard to kind of go into my biology class and kind of like go through the same, because I was caught between two worlds, you know? And the moment that he watched that documentary, he kind of felt the same way. So next thing I know, we start this group, Stanford Peace. I'll never forget going to my mom's house, making flyers, and Marco and Silvan, Sumit and Angie and RD were the first people to be at that meeting for Stand for Peace, you know, like we're gonna stand for peace. And I kind of forgot about the rest of my classes. And so one of the fundraisers, the Fuzzy 50, oh my god, Eric has this idea, he wants to wear it. The Warm Fuzzy is Spectrum's mascot, and it was kind of funny because we used to joke and believe that the previous grad class kind of made it a joke to make, because they chose this as their mascot. And for anyone that ever watched South Park, it kind of looks like Mr. Hank, you know, like this big brown wool suit, this blue school boy shirt that says the Warm Fuzzy on it. And a lot of people did not want to wear that outfit, but yours truly rocked it pretty good. So I was like, oh, you know what, the Fuzzy 50, and the Fuzzy 50 was going to be me wearing the mascot outfit, running around the fields of Spectrum 50 times, and the only reason I chose the Fuzzy 50 is because it rhymed, you know, it just makes sense, poetic justice. So same thing. My close group of friends kind of laughed about it, but they were there with me. They carried me. They loved and they made sure that I made it across that finish line. And in grade 12, we had fuzzy 50 second anniversary, you know? Grade 11, first came up with the idea. Grade 12, we're gonna do it bigger this year, but we waited a little too late in the year, and it was 28 degrees in May with a 20-pound wool suit. And just to make the bulk of the suit, you had to wear one of those like goalie, like what goalies wear in the NHL to stop the puck is what you have to wear just to make the bulk of the suit. So I'm wearing that and I'm running around and it's 28 degrees. The next thing I know, I'm delirious, heat stroke, dumping ice on me. All of a sudden I go to like hypothermia. But the last few laps I remember, Marco and Silvan, either side of me, carrying me across that finish line. I'll never forget that. Because all of a sudden I pass out and Marco's holding my hand, telling me it's going to be okay. And Silvan had to run to the principal and contact the ambulance. And then the next thing I know, I'm in the hospital waking up and it's the same people there holding my hand and telling me it's going to be okay. And Silvan's mom heard about what happened and she matched. She matched what we raised, and it was about $400. And she dared any other parent to match the same. And next thing I know, I'm final school assembly, I'm not graduating, lost a very close friend of mine at the same time. But Silvan and Marco were my support system. So I'm standing on top of the stage with all these kids that are about to graduate, move on with their lives to university, and you and I'm not, but I'm holding a check for a school that was built in Sierra Leone. Next thing I know, I'm invited into the office and asked, like, why do you want to name this school? I named it Brocobera, you know, a close friend of mine. With an unrelentless spirit, you know, the kind of spirit that even after passing will always live on. Which was a very special thing for me, you know, being part of a group like this, stand for peace. And so Mr. Gordon was inclined to make this album to represent, you know, standing for peace and love and unity, you know, like through strife and pain, the kind of love you can manifest. So 6 years later, I found myself cold at the other end of the island, running across Vancouver Island for the same thing. Except now it's like Woodstock in Africa. But the same people supported me through all of that. And I'll never forget October 14th.
Hey, what's up, world? It's Eric Mazapaka with Zion Studios. It is October 14th today, and we're about 200 kilometers away from Victoria. We're on Fanny Bay right now, and the last 2 days have been really hard on my body and my legs. Actually, the last week and a half has been really hard on my body and my legs, so that's kind of an understatement. But some changes. This is the last stop with Silvan Herberger. With having somebody for a checkpoint.
Because Silvan just got back from Germany. He's like, yeah, man, I'll drive you up. I'll make sure that you can, like, finish the rest of your run. And by this point, I have about 300 kilometers left until I hit Victoria. So then, past due point, all of a sudden I felt, oh, it's not the way it's supposed to be, you know, like, Silvan was the guy I was looking forward to, like, running up to him, and like, anyone that knows Silvan, that smile, and that laugh, and that support, like, yeah, like, it's gonna be okay, that's what I was looking forward to, and he was the guy that, trained me before the run, and he was the guy that gave me the belief, you know, he was the essence of every footstep I took, you know, like, so when I ran up to the car and I told him, hey, Silvan, you know what, you're gonna go back by yourself, I gotta make the last lap. Or the not the last lap, but like the last few hundred kilometers by myself. He understood right away. He gave me this warm smile and he was like, so are you gonna go have food? And he fed me. Made sure that I could do this ride, and I asked him, hey, could you make this last video for me?
big sign on my back.
It says Running World Music, Rwanda 2014, Change Not Fear, ScienceStudios.com.
So, it's funny, the last few kilometers is when it hit me, and this is my goodbye, my last video blog, until I see you guys, and hopefully my body can keep up with my spirit. And one love, guys, and see you guys when I get back. Peace. Ah.
Everything. And next thing I know, he's hugging me. He gives me his mom's backpack because the one I'm wearing is like a shoulder bag that all I have is dirty laundry and nothing else. Spandex. It's a little like windbreaker. And next thing I know, he hugs me after feeding me. Gives me a little like supply pack, gives me his mom's whistle just in case a bear comes about. He hugs me and gives me this hug that, you know, I'll see you on the other side kind of thing. Like, when you make it back, like, or when you, wherever you make it, just give me a call. So I'm trying to make my way to Qualicum Beach so I can pass out. And then 3.5 hours right after Silvan drops me off at the checkpoint, and he's just driving away, and he's gonna tell everyone, Eric, I left Eric up there, and no cell phone, no money. At least I fed him. But I was prepared, you know, it was a pilgrimage. It had nothing to do with raising money, it had nothing to do with anything like that. And next thing I know, 3.5 hours later, a truck pulls up, and I'm thinking, oh, they're probably asking about the sign. This old Dutchman pulls up in a truck, and he's like, hey, so, What's the deal? Why are you in the middle of nowhere? So I explain my story and I'm telling him that I'm running for freedom. You know, that's what I'm running for, you know? To celebrate our origins, you know? We always pray and we say, Our Father, Lord in Heaven, thou be my name. But every time I said that prayer as a child, I always imagine, like, if it's Our Father, who's our mother? And I look at my mother and look at Africa, and I'm like, that's our mother, that's our motherland. Like, how could we be so abusive? How could we be so neglectful of our mother? You know, like, we always pray to our father, but we need our mother. And this man just looked at me with the kind of love and embrace that Silvan looked at me. And the moment that Silvan dropped me off, and all of a sudden this 82-year-old Dutchman finds this young Rwandese man on the side of the highway and decides to stop over and question and ask, why are you running? And he was a very spiritual individual, and right, he's asking me where I'm going to sleep, and I'm going to tell him how I'm going to go to the beach and pass out. And next thing I know, he's smiling, talking to me. He's like, you know what, there's a church close to a town called Bowser, which is about 70 kilometers before Nanaimo. And I'm convinced that I'm going to make my way all the way to Qualicum Beach, pass out next day, make my way to Nanaimo, and that's it. You know, it's not that complicated in my mind. But everyone else is like, no, what do you mean? Like, you just can't make something like, make that kind of distance without nothing. But my mind was already set, so he kind of understood that. And it's kind of funny, the same energy that I got from him and the love in essence was the exact same that I got from Silvan just before I left. So he's like, well, you know what, continue on your journey. And he drives off, and the next thing I know, I'm walking a few hours later, and now I'm dark, it's cold, and I'm like walking. I'm like, this is a horrible mistake, I'm an idiot. How could I quit my job? Where the hell, like, what am I doing with my life? Like, what's going on? And all of a sudden, I just passed Bowser, and then all of a, like, I look down the road, and by this point, it's so dark that I can only see when cars are driving by. So all of a sudden, I just passed the town of Bowser. I look up and this car drives by me, and I look ahead and all of a sudden I see this. I'm like, what is that running across the street? I was wishing it was a deer, but he wasn't. He was a bear. So then I'm like, oh, sweet. So I grab this whistle that Silvan gives me and put it in my lips, and I'm like, right, it's freezing in the middle of nowhere. I'm like, why am I wearing tights in the middle of nowhere? And then all of a sudden this Jeep pulls in front of me, and I'm like, oh, they're probably asking about the sign on my back. So I'm running up to the Jeep, just happy to share my story. And it's Ewan. the 82-year-old Dutchman. And he was like, you know what, I felt uncomfortable just driving without even offering you like food or anything. So next thing I know, I'm in a car with this 82-year-old Dutchman who drives me back to his home because he wants to feed me. He feels a necessity just to feed me. And it's the same feeling that I got with Silvan before, like just this spirit of giving, you know, like it's not even, there's probably a lot of people out there who've been around those kind of people, and it's just the essence of caring, you know, past the point that you don't even care about your own well-being, you just care about other people. Because next thing I know, he picks up a strange young, like, I'm sorry, but like, if I was running by with a sign on my back in the middle of nowhere, it's kind of amazing somebody could just pick you up and offer you food and a home. So the next thing I know, I'm in this beautiful home with this Dutchman that just had this spirit that he was telling me how he had cancer a few years ago and he prayed for it to be gone and it did go, and he told me the power of belief. And next thing I know, I'm sitting there and he kept reciting all these passages from the Bible. And I'm not bound by a specific religion, but I'm very spiritual, very. But the way he spoke and the way he believed and the way he loved made me almost kind of tear up. And next thing I know, I'm asking him, hey, like, Jan, do you have a Bible that I could read before I go to bed? And he gives me this smile and he looks at me and goes on like rummaging through something, and he walks out and he just like hands his golden Bible to me. I'll never forget that, because Silvan was the first person I called to make sure that, hey, you know, I'm okay, I made it. Next thing I know, I'm getting handed this golden Bible by an 82-year-old Dutchman named Jan. And for anyone that doesn't know the history of colonization in Africa, it's Dutch. That had a lot to do with that. So even the sign on my back running for World Music Festival in Rwanda 2014 changed off here, that wasn't my sign that I made. It was made by the mother of Kevin Brett Ashtar. A mentor of my growth. And while I was in Courtney, I remember staying at his parents' house, and they were Belgium. His mom was from Belgium, and Belgium was who colonized Rwanda. And she saw it while I was running, and Kevin told all these stories, and she felt the necessity to make a sign for me. So this Belgium family who colonized Rwanda, the turmoil kind of came up from that, created a sign for a young Rwandese immigrant who all of a sudden finds himself on Vancouver Island running across with the sign because she made it. And a Belgian man, actually no, a Dutchman, sorry, they gave me a golden Bible so I could read it for the next 23 hours that I walked so I could make it to Nanaimo and see that beautiful sunset. So Silvan, I thank you for this golden Bible. And I thank you for this album that I'll never forget, Spectrum for Africa. Because 06, we were still doing the same thing. And I'll see you in Africa. And we will celebrate the origins. And we'll go back to our motherland. Thank you once again, Eric Mazapaka with Science Studios, and the story of Silvan and the Golden Bible. I love you, Silvan, and thanks for taking care of everyone. God bless.